I'm everyone. It's nice to see you. I'm Steve Willis. I'm one of the founders of Hope Sheds Light, along with my very handsome partners, Arvo and Ron. We welcome you to our family support meeting. I love these things, and I hope you'll feel the same way afterwards. But we're very grateful that you're here. For your newcomers, thank you. Thank you for being with us, and we thank all of our friends on Facebook for joining us too. Hope Sheds Light, if you're new to us, is a nonprofit. We are dedicated to raising awareness and educating individuals, families, and the community about the impacts of addiction by sharing our personal experiences, by having the courage to do that, by offering strength and wisdom, and by providing hope and resources so that everybody can achieve long-term recovery, everybody in the entire family. Our desire is to remove the fear and stigma of this disease by offering a place where you have the courage, you know, to share with us, and we share with you. So that's our, you know, that's our idea about hope. We started these family support meetings in order to do just that, so you have a place to feel comfortable and know that you have support. We meet on the second and fourth Tuesday of every month in this beautiful Holy Cross Lutheran Church. So thank you. Again, these meetings are open to anyone. Anyone that's affected by the disease or anyone that just wants to learn more. We want you to know that there's an effective, supportive environment here for you so that you're not alone. So the first part of these family support meetings is an educational piece. We have some wonderful, talented colleagues that are here. Lindsay will introduce them and we thank them. That educational part lasts about 45 minutes, and then we break out into groups, which I love, and we'll share what we heard, and we'll ask questions, and we'll share with you ways to take care of yourselves and to love in the right way, okay? And after that, we can come back in here for about 5 or 10 minutes and share some of the takeaways from tonight's fellowship. So thank you all for being here. We're very grateful. Let me turn it over to Lindsay. Thank you.
Now I feel so far back. Welcome, everybody, and thank you again. I would like to introduce Nicole Earhart and Chelsea Hoagland. They work for Footprints for Recovery. Nicole is the clinical director, and Chelsea is a substance abuse counselor. So without further ado.
Hi, everybody. My name is Nicole. I'm the clinical director at Footprints to Recovery. We're an outpatient substance abuse facility in Hamilton, New Jersey. And a big piece of our program and what we offer is our family component on Saturdays. So we're kind of bringing a piece of our family program here to share with all of you and talking about this important topic of setting boundaries with compassion with our loved ones who are struggling with addiction.
Hi everybody, I'm Chelsea Hoagland. I'm a primary substance abuse counselor at Footprints. And part of the work that I do at Footprints is focusing on mindfulness. So that's something we're gonna focus on tonight as we're talking. So before every group that I run, so in group treatment, I facilitate a deep breathing exercise for the clients. Now what deep breathing does is get you focused in the moment. Allows clients to be fully present in the moment so they can really absorb what's going on in group. So I'm gonna lead a deep breathing exercise before we get started with our talk tonight. So if everyone could just get as comfortable as possible in the seat that they're sitting in. You can plant your feet on the floor. We plant our feet on the floor to remind us of where we are right now. Not what we did 5 minutes before we got here, or a mistake we might have made earlier in the day, and not focusing on the future, what we're gonna do later on when we leave tonight. Just allowing our minds to come to this present moment. Again, we say keeping our thoughts where our feet are. So where are we right now? You can wiggle your toes and your shoes, again, reminding you of where you are. You can keep your eyes open for this exercise. If you feel more comfortable with your eyes open, just pick a focal point in front of you and allow your attention to gaze there. Allowing what's in front of you to become what's in focus. Everything else is blurry. So right now, the focus is on this moment. And if you're more comfortable closing your eyes, you can certainly do that. So allowing your upper eyelashes to meet your lower eyelids and softly closing your eyes. You feel your back up against the chair. Chair is supporting you and holding you. Again, reminding you of where you are. You can release any tension that you might feel in your neck or your shoulders. Being mindful of mind-body sensations. So noticing throughout the day, if you feel angry or anxious, noticing where you feel it in your body, and you can send a couple of deep breaths to those places to loosen and relax them. You can place your hands on your knees, palms facing down. If you feel that you need a little bit more grounding, if you feel that your head's a little scattered and you're having difficulty focusing on this moment, hands can face down. If you feel that you need a little bit more energy to get you through the rest of your night, your palms can face up so you can receive energy from the earth. Again, just becoming present in this moment. Letting go. Letting go of anything that does not serve you right in this moment. So we're going to do three deep diaphragmatic breaths. Diaphragmatic breathing means we're breathing into our bellies. So when we breathe in, we're going to breathe in and fill up our belly like we just ate Thanksgiving dinner. A lot of times when we become anxious, we're breathing from our chest, and that's labored breathing. And that's not the proper way to breathe. So sometimes when you're having anxiety, you can simply do a couple of deep breaths to redirect the breath into the diaphragm. And by doing this, you reduce physical symptoms of anxiety, which in turn can help reduce your thoughts and your feelings that support those anxious feelings. So we're going to breathe in through the nose, and we're going to do it for a count of four. We're going to hold for a count of four. And we're going to breathe out for a count of four. I really want you to focus on the exhale. So when you're breathing out, letting go of anything that doesn't serve you, that's causing you stress. Imagine it being breathing out of your system on the out-breath. Just letting it go. So a lot of times we focus on doing a mantra when we're breathing. So we're going to do a simple one tonight. On the breath in, we're going to breathe in the word, imagine the word let. And when you breathe out, imagine the word go. So breathe in, let, breathe out, go. And just imagine what that means to you. So we're going to get started by breathing in through the nose for two, three, four, holding for two, three, four, and breathing out for three. Breathing in for two, three, four, holding, two, three, four, and breathing out, three, four. Breathing in, two, three, four, holding. Differences you might feel in your thoughts, in your body, after simply doing a couple of deep breaths. And knowing that you can always access deep breathing. Right? So if you're ever feeling anxious, overwhelmed, angry, stressed, feeling overwhelmed by emotion, you need to take a step back and do a couple of deep breaths to help you feel centered.
Okay, so we're going to get started and dive right into our topic of setting boundaries and doing so with compassion for both our loved one who's struggling with addiction, as well as compassion for ourselves as the family members, as a support system. So having that sense of empathy, the sense of self-love, and being able to kind of hold that safe place around us so that we can be at peace and then in turn be a positive support to our loved one. So to get started in being able to identify different types of boundaries that we probably see a lot in
our relationships, right? So as humans, we respond a lot of times in our emotions and extremes. So we a lot of times see these extreme boundaries of either complete enmeshment or complete detachment, rigidness, completely detached from the relationship or the individual. So maybe let's start by talking about enmeshment. I think that's a word that most of you are probably familiar with hearing, and what enmeshment looks like. So can anyone just shout out a couple of qualities of what an enmeshed boundary might look like in a relationship? Think of what it sounds like, right?
Unhealthy.
It's unhealthy, right? Anything in an extreme is unhealthy. What else? Very easy to lose your sense of self in a relationship where you have enmeshed boundaries, because you and that individual, basically your boundaries are completely let down, your doors are wide open, and it allows for that codependence to begin to develop. A lot of times, you know, there's difficulty saying no, giving too much, getting involved in things too quickly, maybe being too involved in things that maybe we shouldn't be involved in. And trusting too easily. So that's the one extreme that a lot of times we hear in relationships. The other is having rigid boundaries or being extremely guarded, right? A lot of times when we're hurt over and over and over again, our trust has been broken, we put our walls up, and our walls are completely up, and there's nothing that's going to penetrate or get through those walls. What happens to that relationship then? Is that an equation for a relationship to progress and to move on and to thrive? No, it's going to be really, really hard, really hard. If anyone's seen the TED Talk about the opposite to addiction is connection, I mean, that's a great talk that kind of speaks to that, right? That need to connect, and who more so to need to connect with than our loved ones and our supports in our lives? So, we know what not to do, right? We know that these both are not healthy, right? And very easily to fall into either one of those, especially, like I said, when we're dealing with high emotions with our loved ones in our lives. So the key is being able to create healthy boundaries, finding something that's somewhere in the middle, that gray area, that balance. So what might those boundaries look like? Do you want to talk a little bit about that piece?
So if boundaries are like a wall, right, there's no way to get through it, right? You're just putting up that wall, and you're holding that steadfast, that's the boundary, and there's no way to penetrate that boundary. There's no way to get in. So that's talking about a rigid boundary, right? Or if they could be like, or if you picture a wall with a gate that's always left open, then maybe that's more of an enmeshed boundary, where there's no clearly defined people. It just exists as, I'm here to serve you, you're here to serve me. There's no boundary, right?
But I'm okay if you're okay, type of thinking.
Or a wall that has a gate that functions, allowing things to come in and things to go out, knowing when to shut the gate when things are becoming unhealthy, and knowing when to open it. And being able to be okay with your decision to open and to close.
So healthy boundaries also have that sense of flexibility, right? So like Chelsea said, being able to both close and open that gate, letting people in, and then also knowing when enough is enough and it's time for me to shut my gate because I need to center myself and be okay with what's happening. So having that ability and that insight to be able to have that sense of control in our relationships, because a lot of times it's our behaviors are going to then reflect on the individual in the relationship, and they're going to respond in a certain way to our own behaviors. So we can be the start of change in the relationship. If we start to change our boundaries, then they're going to have to start to change in response to it. And that can be pretty empowering. I think a lot of times when we're thinking about individuals in active addiction, you know, we're praying and hoping that they will be the ones to make the change, but sometimes we have a little bit more control in the situation with our relationships than we think, because we have control over ourselves
and over what we allow in and what we let out and what we give. So being able to be flexible, being able to let go of destructive moments and experiences, knowing what's unhealthy for us, what's making us unwell, and being able to say no, being able to put to close the gate, connecting with nurturing happy, healthy moments. So it's not about just shutting the whole thing out, it's about really connecting with those happy moments, connecting with the good things that we can in the relationship, and staying connected in one way, but then being able to kind of keep ourselves safe from the unhealthy experiences. Protecting ourselves from mistreatment, unhealthy communication, and being able to read the cues that someone might be acting in a selfish or somewhat abusive way towards us. And being able to maneuver our boundaries in response to that to keep ourselves well and to keep ourselves safe. So integrating compassion, right, because that's what this is all about, how to be compassionate for the individual, how to build compassion for ourselves, and learn to be able to put ourselves first and keep ourselves well. Can you speak a little about that piece?
So first I just want you to take a minute, maybe just close your eyes, picture your relationship with your loved one that's suffering from addiction. What do the boundaries look like with that person? Do you have difficulty saying no? Or maybe you say no too often? Or maybe you have established that healthy boundary. Maybe you have worked in conjunction with a counselor or any type of treatment, and you have that healthy boundary, and you're able to create that safe, tranquil space for both your loved one and for yourself.
So that's that piece of being able to kind of start to develop the insight into our relationship, and then being able to recognize where we can integrate some compassion into the boundaries that we're setting. Being able to, quote unquote, close the gate with love, right? Being able to care for the individual while still caring for ourselves, and being able to support them without necessarily supporting their behaviors. And the purpose is really to keep, like I was saying earlier, to keep ourselves as the family members and the support healthy and at peace and stable. Because how else can we support others unless we ourselves are well and taking care of ourselves? That self-care piece is so, so important. So noticing some of the signs that maybe some of the boundaries that are currently existing might need a little bit of work or a little shift. So noticing that if we're talking a lot about the past, right? So Chelsea's breathing exercise is a great way to practice focusing on the now, what's happening now in this moment, you know, letting go of what's happened in the past, not projecting into what's happening in the future or what we think is going to happen, and really taking in the present moment and connecting with that moment. Noticing, you know, things like guilt trips, dictating what may or should be happening or not happening, criticism, maybe providing solutions when solutions aren't necessarily being asked for, covering things up, feeling like you kind of might need to walk on eggshells because you're afraid of what response you might get, and then feeling overall of being taken advantage of, feeling as though the relationship isn't really an equal give and take, it's more of being walked up all over or taken advantage of. So those are all signs of probably needing to establish or shift our boundaries a little bit in our relationships, and being able to, again, reset the tone and putting ourselves first, and then knowing that our loved one will then respond to that in a way that hopefully is healthier than the pattern we've been seeing.
So verbalizing and communicating what is acceptable and what is not acceptable, as well as what consequences there will be for unacceptable behavior. And I know that that can be a hugely difficult thing to establish, right? But it's important for your own self-preservation. situation and to help preserve your loved one by setting up those consequences and adhering to them.
The agreements that we're making in our relationship are what's going to help hold one another accountable, and it's keeping us each responsible in the relationship. So the minute that you set up an agreement and somebody backs out of the agreement and then we allow that to happen without consequence or without follow-up, where is that going to lead, right? It's putting all responsibility out the window, and both parties really are at fault in that because we're allowing that to happen.
It's also allowing your loved one to be responsible for their actions. And maybe there's going to be legal consequences, but you can't protect them from everything, right? And I know a lot of times as parents, as with our children and our loved ones, we want to protect them from everything. But sometimes the consequences need to happen in order for change to happen, right? In order for that inner drive for them to want that change to happen. That we have to allow these things to happen, as difficult as it may be to watch someone, you know, receive a legal consequence for their actions, someone that we care about. Also increasing their sense of taking responsibility for their addiction and encouraging, but allowing them to seek the help as well. Because as we all know, we can't make someone want to change. We can help inspire them, but it's ultimately their decision.
And are they really going to be able to get to that place if we're following them around with the shield, right, trying to protect them? Like, getting to that space and where they can build that motivation and that recognition to want to make the change in their life, we have to take a step back as the loved ones and allow that to happen sometimes. And it's hard, right? It's emotional. It's painful as parents, as spouses, sisters, neighbors. It's hard when you're emotionally attached to somebody. But sometimes knowing that the end result and the end goal and kind of hanging on to that sense of hope and allowing the process to kind of take place can also lead to a sense of relief, I think, and knowing that that they're going to get to that place to be able to want to make that change instead of us wanting it for them. And no more insulting, right? Being very aware of our language and what we're saying. Sticks and stones, right? Words have weight. Words affect people. And maintaining our values as the loved ones and speaking in a loving, compassionate way while, you know, withholding these boundaries that we're talking about. Financial boundaries, I think that's pretty, you know, self-explanatory, whether it's related to legal situations, bills, whatever it is. Again, any way that we can increase the sense of personal responsibility in our loved one that's struggling with addiction, that's going to help increase their sense of responsibility in their illness and their need to change it. Boundaries with time. An example that we hear a lot is, you know, we set up Sunday dinner or holiday and they said they were coming and they didn't show up. So, you know, where's the boundary in that? Do we stop inviting them? You know, what kind of boundary is that? Or do we invite them and set the agreement? You know, holiday starts at 6. If you can be here at 6, you're more than welcome to come. We would love to have you here. If you can't make it on time, I'm sorry. You know, maybe next year. Being able to kind of have that sense of compassion and also stay firm with the boundary. And then we have to be able to stick with it, right? They show up at 9, it's not 6, you know? And that's where that responsibility piece comes in. And as I had mentioned, you know, that idea of compassion, it's what allows us to remain hopeful. And holding on to that hope, you know, that's what's going to get you through to the next day and get you through until that space where you're really able to see the change and see the progress and see the miracles that we're able to see every day in the work that we do.
I bet upholding these boundaries and implementing them, it seems hard at first, right? But in the end, I think all of our ultimate goal is to help our loved one. And by putting these boundaries in place, that's what you're ultimately doing. So I'm just going to speak a little bit about how to put yourself first and how to take care of yourself, right? Because we know that addiction affects the whole family and everyone that's involved and everyone that loves the person that's suffering. So it's so important to maintain and protect your own peace during times that are rough, right, with a loved one. And how do we do that? How do we put ourselves first by still feeling that we're caring and that we're being compassionate towards our loved one? So an important thing to do is to know that it's okay and it's important to let go of controlling your loved one's involvement in treatment, right? So taking the advice of the counselor and engaging with the counselor and attending those family sessions and being there, but not trying to run the show, right? Relinquishing control. Of course, because it's ultimately the person who's seeking help, and it's ultimately, you know, their goals and their things that they're striving for in treatment that are the most important, right? So letting them come to those things on their own. Adhering to a really, really good self-care routine, a healthy self-care routine, means taking care of yourself, seeking the help you need when needed, seeking the help of a counselor, right? Making sure you're taking care of yourself appropriately. You're eating right, you're exercising, you're meditating, you're maintaining a normal sleep schedule. And knowing that in taking care of yourself, you're in turn taking care of them. Because if you allow yourself to fall and to become sick during this process, you're not going to be able to help them or help yourself. So it's extremely important to make sure that your self-care is a priority. And so often we see that it becomes not the priority, right? Because you're so worried that person's, that your loved one's situation is more important than your own.
And it's about modeling too, right? Modeling healthy routines, modeling these boundaries, so that our loved ones who are struggling can see that and then in turn hopefully start to establish some kind of routine of their own. It brings to mind for me that whole like practice what you preach, right? Being able to practice what we're suggesting and being able to take those suggestions and then in turn put them into play in our own lives are so important. And self-care is a huge part of this. As the loved one struggling with addiction and as the family members in the support system. So being able to know when you're being affected, right? How do you know when you're starting to be affected by someone else's behaviors and someone else's decisions? How do you know when maybe you need to reach out for help or support? You know, what brought you here into this room to reach out, you know, to your peers? And being able to be proactive in that and knowing ourselves and having that insight to know that it's okay to need help. It's okay to need to lean on others and get the support that we need as well, whether it's through support groups like this, seeking therapy on our own, staying connected to our own routines, whatever it is for you that makes you feel whole and healthy and at peace, being able to do that and being able to put ourselves first. So that's kind of the premise of the educational portion. But one of the things that we do a lot at Footprints with our clients and then also as part of our family day is practicing some of the skills right there together. So I think, Chelsea does one of the best guided meditations I've experienced. So being able to share that with you and being able to practice it right now in this moment, and similar to the breathing exercise that we did earlier, this is something that you can do on your own and you can do for yourself.
So I hold meditation groups where I do guided meditations, and there's various different topics that we do them on. There's mindfulness. I'm going to, with you today, tonight I'm going to do a peaceful place imagery meditation. So this guides you to a calm place and evokes you to bring up images of different places in nature that are calming for you. Meditation is an extremely important part of self-care. I always say that meditation is my favorite time of day because it's a time of day when I don't have to be anybody for anyone else, and I can just be present for myself. And it's in these moments when we're being and not doing, right? Because we live in a society where we're always running from one thing to the next. We can do a million different things in a day, but we never take time to just sit and be. And a lot of times we're exhausted, we're overwhelmed, that's part of being a person, right? Is to be able to take that time for yourself. And it's in these moments when you can be still and you can be silent, you can be meditating, that you can better connect to yourself and always find out more about yourself in those moments where you're allowing yourself to be calm and still. So it's all about balance, right? So we're running around all day, working, picking people up, going to the food store, shopping. It's doing, doing, doing. And we forget that part of, you know, being a human being is to just be. So I'm going to read the meditation on peaceful place. So, like I said, in the breathing, you can keep your eyes open if you're more comfortable, but just allow your gaze just to go on to one spot. Or you can close your eyes. And a lot of times, like, my clients will tell me, oh, Chelsea, I can't meditate. My mind just moves too fast, I can't focus. And meditation is a practice. It's not a good meditation, it's not a bad meditation. Meditation just is. So sometimes, yes, it might be easier to access that place where you can be calm and you can be still, and other times it might not be as easy. It's never about judgment, right? We want to create a place of compassion for yourself, and this is how one way you can build compassion for yourself, is noticing when the mind begins to wander, as it will, because that's the nature of the mind, is to your thoughts to wander, just to lovingly bring it back each time. Just notice it. Okay, my mind wandered. So I'm just going to bring it back to the words. And if you have a hard time focusing on the words, then just focus on the breath. And I'll cue it, so you'll be cued to breathe in and breathe out. But knowing that this is a time and space, that it might seem silly or you don't have time, right? But these are the things that are most important. So taking those few minutes a day, there's a lot of different like mindfulness meditations on YouTube that you can access and listen to. But these are some of the most important moments that can't be forgotten throughout the day. So make self-care and reconnecting to yourself a priority, because in turn it'll make easier in life. Okay, so just get comfortable. And like I said, if you're more comfortable with your eyes open, you can do that, but you can close your eyes. So softly allowing your upper eyelashes to meet your lower eyelids. And again, if your mind wanders throughout the meditation, just bring it back lovingly. Okay, my mind wandered, so no big deal, no judgment. So please take a moment or two to position yourself as comfortably as you can, allowing your body to be well supported. And gently letting your eyes close if they want to. And arranging it so your head, neck, and spine are straight. And letting your hands rest comfortably somewhere on your body, on your chest, or midriff, or abdomen. So you can feel the rise of your body when you breathe in, and the way it settles back down when you breathe out, and you're becoming more and more attuned to the feel of your breath moving in and out of your body. Breathing in and breathing out. Breathing in and breathing out. And now taking a nice, deep, full, cleansing breath. And breathing out fully and completely. Feeling the expansion of your belly with each breath in and the way your body subsides with each out breath. And again, breathing in. And this time, imagining that you're sending the warm energy of your breath to places in your body that might be sore or tense or tight. And releasing the tension with the out-breath. So you can feel your breath going into those places, warming and softening and loosening them. And then gathering it all up and breathing it out. So that more and more you can feel safe and comfortable, relaxed and easy, watching the cleansing action of your breath. And unwelcome thoughts, those too can be sent out with the exhale. So that just for a moment, your mind is empty, free and clear space, and you are blessed with peaceful stillness. And any emotions you might sense inside, those two can be noted and breathed out of your body. So you can be still and quiet, like a smooth and glassy lake with no ripple. Breathing in and breathing out. Breathing in. And now, if you would, see if you can imagine a place where you feel safe and peaceful, relaxed and easy. And it might be a place you used to go to, or somewhere you go to now. Or a place you've always wanted to be. It could be by the ocean, or in the woods, or up in the mountains or desert. It doesn't matter. Just so you choose one of the places that feel good and peaceful to you. And allowing this place to become real in all its dimensions. Looking around you. Enjoying the colors, the play of light and shadow, the scenery in all of its detail. Looking over to your left and over to your right and feeling whatever you're sitting against or lying upon. Whether
whether you're leaning against a friendly old oak tree or lying on sweet meadow grass or walking in the woods on a fragrant carpet of spicy pine needles. Or you might be walking in the surf with cool, wet sand oozing between your toes and gentle waves lapping at your ankles. Or maybe you're just sitting on a nice warm rock in the sun. Breathing in and breathing out. Breathing in and breathing out. And listening to the sounds of the place. Birds singing or the rustling sounds of a soft wind through the leaves. Or the powerful rhythmic crash of ocean waves. Or the gentle soothing sound of a bubbling brook. Just so you're letting your ears become attuned to all of the beautiful sounds of this place. This place that is so safe and peaceful to you. Breathing in and breathing out. Breathing in and breathing out. And smelling its rich fragrance, whether it's the sharp, bracing scent of salt sea air, the sweet, heavy fullness of flowers and grass, the pungent, dark green smell of peat moss in the forest. Sometimes the air is so rich and redolent, you can practically taste it on your tongue. And noticing the feel of the air on your skin as it caresses your face and neck, and it might be crisp and dry, or balmy and wet. So you're just letting your skin enjoy the nourishing presence of this place that is so safe and peaceful to you. And letting its healing energy soak into your skin. Letting it fill you. Feeling it move into muscle and tissue and bone, all the way down into each and every cell. Breathing in and breathing out. Breathing in. So with every breath, you're inhaling the nourishing beauty of this place, bringing it into your body, breathing it into your heart. And with each exhale, you're more and more able to release whatever you wish to let go of. Breathing deeply and easily, taking the peaceful beauty of the place into your body with each in-breath, and letting it move all through you, and breathing whatever you wish to release, strong and steady, in and out. Peaceful and easy. And so whenever you are ready, taking another full, deep breath, and gently with soft eyes coming back into the room whenever you are ready, knowing in a deep place that this place is inside of you, that you are better for this, and so you are. Take a few moments to reorient back into the room. Just notice any difference in the way that you feel after meditating. Does anyone have any questions after the meditation or any comments?
I just say thank you. It's been many, many years since I was in guided meditation. I really enjoyed it.
Good. That's awesome. You can do it any time, right? It's just creating that time for ourselves, because so easily we forget about ourselves when we're taking care of other people, right? And it's a few moments a day. There's tons of, like, you can go on apps on your phone. There's the Headspace app. There's the mindfulness app that reminds you to meditate. There was such a big movement for meditation, you know, more Eastern culture, and being able to ground ourselves and center ourselves with meditation, just slow everything down because we're moving so fast so often.
Any other questions? Thank you again for having us. It was our pleasure to be here.
Thank you so much to both of you. That was incredible. I feel relaxed. I don't know about anybody else. Okay, so let me come back to the room. I'm going to remind everyone about the surveys. We have Desiree and Susan volunteering to hand out the surveys. So make sure you fill them out and hand them back in so that we have them for data collection purposes. And we're going to try a little something different with the beads and divvying up the groups. So we have three facilitators. We have a red group, we have a yellow group, and we have a blue group. So each of the facilitators are going to stand up one at a time, and we're going to just separate and go down to the hall. Does that make sense? So whoever has the blue beads will stand up and say, I have the blue group, and we're going to guide everybody out to their designated rooms.
Who's blue?
Yeah?
Steve, I have to get the surveys first.
Is that? I got
the surveys. Oh, I also want to make an announcement and a reminder about the Day of Hope that's coming up Saturday at our facility on 253 Chestnut. There's flyers out in the hallway that explain the timing and the address for the Day of Hope. Come out. We're going to be unveiling our butterfly garden on that day. So come out and enjoy a beautiful day. It's from 11 to 3.